Hi, I'm Glenn Cummings, the president of the University of Southern Maine, and welcome back to the February 2019 USM Update. We're delighted to have you with you. We have a great show. We are going to talk athletics and scholarship and how the two come together at the University of Southern Maine in an excellent way. We're going to talk about name change, and we're going to look at a nationally recognized writing program called Stonecoast. All of those coming right up in just a few minutes. And welcome back to 2019. Happy New Year. What we want to say right now is we've got the opportunity to celebrate a little bit the excellence in our athletics and the excellence in our academics and how the two come together at that athletic department. With us is Al Bean, the athletic director at the University of Southern Maine Division III Sports in the Little East Conference. Al, welcome and thank you for coming.
Thanks,
and thank
Glenn.
You for the 70, 80, 90 hours a week that you end up putting in to help our athletes. So the first thing is, it's really important to be athletic, obviously, and capable to get into Division III, but the thing that we have is a strong expectation around academics. Talk to us about what it means to really support our students in that academic sphere, why they're trying to be a Division III athlete.
Well, I think obviously all of us involved love sports, love athletic pursuits, and we're very passionate and very competitive.
Yeah.
But I think we understand in Division III that most of our people are going to work.
Yes.
So we need to prepare them for the next phase of their life.
They're not going to be in the Super Bowl or something like
it's
that.
Unlikely. Yeah, it's unlikely.
Okay.
We've had some
professional... Since we don't have a football team, it's really looking
really
grim
unlikely,
on that.
Yeah.
But
we've had some folks who go professional in some sports. But
In fact, I met David Hughes.
Yes, absolutely.
He is considered the number one sailing Olympian coming into the next Olympics, by the way, one of our athletes.
That's great.
That's
so, really great.
So what do you do to make sure that their academic standards are also meet up with their
Well, I think from day one, we put a real focus and an emphasis on the fact that, you know, you need to go to work.
Yeah.
You need to prepare yourself for the next phase of your life.
Yeah.
And we're going to hold you to some academic standards and push you to try to make sure that you get there. And we introduce our scholar-athlete program from the very start, and we've had that in place now from the mid-'80s.
Yeah.
And every single year, the number of athletes who achieve that goes up to the point now where we have about 219 last year that met scholar-athlete status.
What is that? Is that 3.0?
3.0 or better for the year. Yeah. And, you know, we are over 3.0 as a full body of 450-plus student-athletes.
That is so impressive. I remember I went to your awards banquet, your academic awards banquet with athletes last fall, and you said it was a record number of athletes had hit that achievement.
Absolutely, and it jumped up by about 20
wow.
last year. So every year that continues to get better.
We got to give a compliment, a shout-out to Kim Turner.
Absolutely.
You were smart enough to bring back to the athletic department. And she basically monitors all the athletes' grades, and then requires them, I think, freshmen to come in and do a study several hours in the evenings.
Yeah. We have a learning center built right into our athletic office area.
Yep.
Freshmen have to be there four hours a week.
Yeah.
And I think the thing that gets lost in there, it isn't just the study time, but it's the fact that they get to know people, they get acclimated, they start to feel comfortable going into people's offices.
Yeah.
If they need help, we find them help. And
point
them in the right direction, either in our department or with learning assistance or with advising, whatever it may be.
That kind of expectation is you will be here during these hours and we will monitor your grades.
Yeah.
I had a one of your student athletes last year in my microeconomics class and a little soft performance there just for a couple weeks, and I one call to Kim Turner, let me just say, that those grades went right up. So there's a lot of good accountability, I think, that you guys bring, a lot of support and a lot of connection. And being a Division III athlete, you know, people say, well, it's not Division I, you're not doing this all the time. I got to tell you, I've seen it up front from watching some of your athletes. Their demands athletically on top of a full-time workload academically is really impressive.
Yes, it is impressive. And I think what some people miss when they hear Division III, their passion and their desire to excel and be part of a great team is no different. So they're putting everything they can into what they're doing.
Yeah. Well, congratulations, by the way, on what you're doing academically, on your many, many victories that you've had in a bunch of sports, and most importantly for all the class and all the grace that you bring to leading our athletes. You come with the best attitude possible, and thank you for your work, Al.
Thank you. It's a real pleasure.
Thank you. We're going to be right back. We're going to bring a few athletes now in and talk to them about their experience of both being a Division III athlete for us in a variety of sports. It will include track, wrestling, basketball, and we'll get it from the students' perspective and the support that they're getting from Al Bean and his team. We'll be right back. Hello and welcome back. Glenn Cummings, the president of the University of Southern Maine, and we're going to continue our conversation about athletics that we just had with Athletic Director Al Bean. We're going to continue it with athletes themselves. To my right is Kim Howergan. She is a senior from Fairfax, Virginia. She is the captain, not Vermont, but we take you even if you're from Virginia. And you are the captain of the women's basketball team, an accounting major, is that right?
Yep.
Right, terrific. And to her right is Ron Helderman. He is a senior as well and a biochemistry major from Madison, Maine. Welcome. And nationally ranked pole vaulter, who is telling me he's seventh in the nation, was second in the nation, and now you're going to be first on Saturday.
Yeah, I'll try.
We'll try it. Okay. And with him is Peter Del Greco. Peter is the number one ranked in his Division III weight class in wrestling. He is a, what kind of major is it, a business?
Exercise science.
Exercise science major, and you are from Gardner, Maine. So, these are three pretty impressive athletes. Let me start off with a sort of a basic question to you. On top of your athletic performances, obviously you've done academics. How have the two gone together? Have they made you just stressful, or has it actually helped you become kind of even more well-rounded person? How have the two gone together, and how have your athletic experiences and your academic experience kind of played on each other in hopefully a positive way? Want to start us off, Kim?
Yeah, so I think, like, in addition to the resources that are available for all students here at the university, I think the athletic department really provides us with, like, all the keys we need to be successful, like, with our teammates. Our teammates are always pushing us to be better, whether it's on the court or
that's really
in
important.
The classroom.
In the classroom, they push you, too, because I know I watched the women's basketball team, and I can tell that they're pushing you to keep, pay attention. They're all very supportive, right?
Yeah,
you get off the field, and they all stand up, and they kind of welcome you back to the bench and stuff like that. But is that true academically? They actually support each other academically?
Yeah, I definitely think so. The women's basketball team specifically, we have been awarded the award for the highest GPA for the past 3 years now. So
you're not rubbing that in with these other two guys, are you?
No, it's kind of like we all kind of push each other just because with athletics, like, we're known for being competitive, so it's kind of...
Good for you. Yeah. That's fantastic. And I know that you truly support each other as well.
Definitely.
So. Ron, tell me about what it means for you to be... You're a biochemistry, which, by the way, is not an easy major. I don't know if you've noticed, but, so to put that kind of level of work in and still do so well in your athletic events must be a challenge. So tell me how it has fit for you.
Yeah, it fits. So practice and track and field, it helps you learn how to work hard out on the track, and I think that helps when you're in the classroom, and and especially in the
pushing
lab.
Pushing yourself a little bit is a good thing to learn early.
That's right. Yeah. And in pole vault, you see the bar going up, and that's kind of one of your measures for success, and so you start learning what you can do the little things right, and that definitely translates to the classroom and the lab.
Can I just, like, I've never pole, I played a lot of basketball, and I've wrestled with my older brother, tell me, is there a freaky moment when you're like bending that pole vault and you think, oh my God, I'm gonna fall backwards?
Sometimes little things like that. And
worst injury, just tell me what was the worst thing
I've
that
pulled
ever
some hamstrings, actually.
That's it.
I haven't taken any hard hits.
Okay,
some
good.
People but
good.
I've been lucky.
I've seen you a couple times. It's really impressive.
Well, thank you.
Way to go. I've seen the women's basketball team, and I've seen your brother wrestle. I'm going to apologize. I don't think I've seen you, but I promise I will do that. Peter, tell us a little bit about you. You are an excellent student. You come from a family of excellent students that have also gone to USM. So tell us a little bit about, for you, what that experience is like in putting those two things together.
I definitely think being an athlete, it definitely motivates me more to do better in school, because I just... Wrestling, you got to push yourself to be the best out of everybody in your weight class. And in school, you want to be the best out of everybody too and get the best grades so you have the best opportunity for the jobs to come when you graduate.
Yeah.
definitely think it goes hand in hand.
Which is a great part of Division III is just what you just said, Peter, is that, you know, Division I, it's kind of like you're either an athlete, basically, and if you roll out and you get an injury or something, a lot of these Division I teams aren't looking at the bigger picture of getting these students to graduate, and we see a lot of documentaries on that and that kind of thing. One of the great things is, you know, our plan is to make sure that you're successful throughout your entire life, not just be successful for us. You've brought a lot of pride, obviously. All three of you have brought a lot of pride to the University of Southern Maine. Well, let me just ask, so when you're thinking about your you know, senior years, particularly two of you looking at your senior years, when you look back at USM, what would be one of the best things you remember about your athletic experiences? I'll just pick on you two seniors a little bit. What is it that you're going to bring with you as you graduate this May?
For me, it's going to be the team that I was a part of, the people that I met, the mentors, the coaches, and you know, just really great people that I got to spend a lot of time and go through a lot of memories with.
What a gift. And you know, the coaches, I know both your coaches really well. They care deeply about you. And that's something that I, as president, take a lot of pride in, that our coaches and our faculty and our staff know and like our students and want them to be successful. And that really means a lot to me. How about you, Kim, as you graduate?
I'd say the same thing, honestly. Being a part of a group of girls who's all like in it together and with like Division III, more so than like Division I, you have people who they're there because they love to play basketball. Like, they're not there, it's not a job for them. So, I mean, I think we all can kind of share like the same qualities in that sense and just build relationships from that.
Yeah, and those relationships will carry you the rest of your life, absolutely. Peter, congratulations on all you've done too, and look forward to getting out there and seeing you, and congratulations on being number one in the country. And I wish the LAC will be dominated by our women's basketball team, and Ron, you're gonna fly over to number one in the country, I think. So we're gonna wrap it up. We'll be right back. We're going to be talking with Mr. Cliff Greim, the head of our Board of Visitors, and we're talking a little bit about the name change at USM. And we'll be back in just a minute to do that. Thank you. Hello and welcome back to the next segment of USM Updates. What a great bunch of athletes we just talked to, and wanted to make a mention of something that I didn't get a chance to talk to them about. The USM Husky Athletic Department and our teams just received a national level award in Division III for their outstanding community service for Special Olympiads. And very impressed, we're very happy with them, very honored to be recognized at the national level for something so important to all of us, which is how do we treat each other, and especially through community service. So congratulations to them. In our next segment now, we're talking with the Board of Visitors Chair, Mr. Cliff Greim. He is the CEO of Harriman Associates out of Auburn, an architectural and engineering firm that has had a long history here in Maine of building great buildings, and we hope you continue to build great buildings for us. So welcome, Cliff, and thank
we
you
share
for
that.
Being us.
Yes, yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. So we're going to talk a little bit about name change and the rationale. You're a business person, and I think you kind of understand at least why we always have to pay attention to demographics in our business. One of the things that we've seen really clearly, perhaps more strongly than we ever want to, is that if you're going to run a university, don't pick Northern New England for enrollment growth, right? So we have to look at every possible angle. You and I have talked about this a lot. Tell us a little bit about why many on the Board of Visitors have been so strongly supportive of a name change.
Well, we all realize that the demographics in the state of Maine are not growing exponentially. You know that, and you've witnessed that. One of the strong strategies that each of the campuses in the University of Maine system employ is trying to attract students from away for a variety of reasons. Yeah. Number one, it's to bring the additional revenue in, which will help reallocate some of those funds for some of our
institutions. Out-of-state tuition and room and board is not the same that the average Mainer pays,
as
it should be.
Absolutely correct. And the other thing that's a really neat statistic is when you take a look at students from away, if they graduate from this institution, they stay within about 70 miles of this institution.
Which is why I say you've got the best possible workers that a business
Absolutely.
Could have. They're loyal to the area, and
right.
they know hard work because many of them have worked 25, 30 right. hours while they're going full time.
Absolutely.
Not what you see in some of these other schools. So
right.
We're really impressed with both of those.
Without a doubt. I would say that strategically, as the University of Maine system looks at all the assets they have on each of the campuses, the asset that this campus has is Portland.
Yeah.
And also Gorham and also Lewis and Auburn. But for recruiting purposes, I think it's easy to recruit to this
That's
community.
Right. Yeah.
And I think we have to leverage that, optimize it, because that will benefit the entire system eventually.
The data was overwhelming on that. I'll get to that in just a minute. But I think you hit the biggest thing possible. You know, I had a cousin who graduated a few years from Morse High School before me back in the mid-70s. And she went up in 1977 to Presque Isle High School, and she taught English there for 41 years and retired this last June. I texted her while I was up at the September board meeting of BOT up at the University of Presque Isle.
Yes.
And I said, Francie, you know, let's have a cup of coffee and say, I just want to say congratulations and wish you the best in retirement. But when we were having a cup of coffee, I said, tell me, do you remember what the population of Presque Isle High School was in 1977? She says, 1,200 kids. I said, when you left in June 2018, what was the population of Presque Isle High School? She said, about 520 kids, maybe 525 kids.
Sure.
She said, that's the story of Northern Maine, Western Maine, Eastern Maine, and quite frankly, even Southern Maine, flat.
Mm.
We're not seeing enrollment growth. The only thing that's helping us, we've got some new Americans. We
yes.
have some more in-migration from out of state than the rest of the state.
Mm-hmm.
So what's happening is there aren't enough bodies. When Angus King often says, when he left in 2002 the governorship,
yeah.
he said, I know how many students there were per grade level. There were about 17,000 per grade level, because he had to buy laptops for every eighth grader.
That's right.
He said, today, just 15 years later, he said, that number is now down to 13,000.
Hmm.
So going down in population overall is not even as dramatic as a steep decline in 18-year-olds and K through 12. So you know, the rationale is, what do we do to make ourselves as attractive as possible for that out-of-state market?
Right.
I will tell you that one of the things that our data found out, which surprised me, I asked our vice president of enrollment, you know, if what percentage of out-of-state students would have to be moved by a name change? And she said, you know, 10, but should be 15%. And I said, fair enough, 15%. 60% of the 450 students that we surveyed out-of-state in southern New England, and actually in Vermont, New Hampshire, and in metropolitan New York, 60% of them said, I would look at your school online, I would visit your school, and I would consider coming to your school at 50%. So 60% said they'd at least visit the school. Five times what we were expecting.
Wow.
So very impressive statistics.
Yeah, strategically, any organization, any business, any institution that can gain exposure of 15% is attractive.
Yeah. Yeah.
If you told any business they could expose and position themselves mm-hmm. and improve their chances by 50%, 60%.
Yeah. In a certain market.
You would have 100% participation.
Yeah.
And so with that kind of diligence that was done, and I compliment you and your staff and this institution for doing that diligence, because it's something that had to be done to validate and figure where is our growth market.
Well, and I'll tell you, and as you know, and we probably all have gotten some pushback from alumni who say, you know, mm-hmm. we really like the name USM, and it reflects us. They've also said some really nice things, which I appreciate. They've said, you're doing well, you've got the enrollment up,
right.
your reserves are up, you're getting big grants, you're getting a good reputation. Just keep doing it, don't want to blow that. And the truth is that, you know, I appreciate that. I really
right.
do. It means a lot to me personally that our alumni feel that way, and our students. But when I actually look at, you know, what I get paid to do, which is, the problem is I can't keep this up if I don't look around the corner. So thank you. I really appreciate that the Board of Visitors you know, kind of understands and supports that.
Right.
It makes a big difference.
And I think it's important to understand that the University of Maine, that name, is recognized as a value to that, and to leverage that, and to clarify that this institution is part of the University of Maine system. I don't know as everybody understands that, both both locally and also from away.
That's right. Well, and I've got just about 30 seconds. I want to say two things. First of all, congratulations on your Citizen of the Year or your chamber at the Lewis and Auburn Chamber of Commerce. It says highly of all the stuff that you do. I know all the stuff you do around here. Mm. I know we're not the only organizations that's blessed by your service. I want to say thank you. And thank you for the work that you've done here. You've been a superb Board of Visitor chair and good steward of the university, good advocate for us. And just use this opportunity to say thank you in public for the work you've done.
Appreciate it. Thank you. Passion.
It helps. You want the best out of the state of Maine, and so do I. So
great.
Very good. Thank you. And thank you again, Cliff.
No, great. Thanks.
We will be right back in just a few minutes. We will be talking to the nationally recognized writing program called Stonecoast here at the University of Southern Maine, a longstanding tradition that something's brought us a lot of honor. We will be right back, and thank you again to Cliff Greim for being here to talk to us about some changes going on here at the university. We'll be right back. Hello, welcome back. Glenn Cummings, the president of the University of Southern Maine. Welcome back to our last segment, which is on the Masters of Fine Arts Stonecoast Writing Program here at the University of Southern Maine. It is considered one of the most diverse, one of the most rigorous, and one of the most interesting or compelling and productive in terms of what you'll see from some of our alumni and alumna from that program. 17-year history, and it is led by our director, Justin Tussing. And welcome, and glad to have you with you. And thanks for all the work that you do to make us proud. And with him is one of our alumna of the Stonecoast Writing Program, Catherine Murray, who is, we are very happy to say, and we'll be promoting this book more directly, but she has just published a book, Now You See the Sky. And we'll be coming back to talk more about what that book is about and why we should go get it and where you can go get it. So let's start off, Justin. So obviously the program works. It has a low residency component, and it's very effective because people really find it both accommodating to their schedules in some ways, and also it's extremely loaded with very high quality instructors, including you, who have experience writing. So tell us a little bit about how the program actually works.
Yeah, so a low residency program, unlike a residential program where you have to move somewhere and relocate, in a low residency program you attend 2 9-day residencies over the course of the year. And while you're there, you get all the workshops, the seminars. Yep. You actually build a sense of community with the students and faculty that are there. So you get to know your cohort.
It's a cohort that goes through together.
Yeah, exactly. And we accept this new cohort that begins every 6 months. Yeah. So we have a class that will begin in June with our next summer residency.
Wonderful.
And then again in January. January 20, I guess, will be the next class.
Wow.
Yeah.
Which is a lot of work on your part to get them all together, moving every
6 months.
We have a
great team. And
yes,
we have a great team.
We'll give some credit, a shout out to Robin Talbot, who is also a major piece of muscle behind all the
She's
work.
She's a muscle
happens.
Honey, yes, indeed.
That's great.
That's great to say.
Wonderful. Well, thank you.
Yeah, so, but the other thing about the program is that when students are coming in, they begin to build their writing life in where they live already. Yeah. So I think that unlike a residential program where you sort of disconnect from your life to go do your study program, right. Here you're living your life and writing in the same place, whether it's at your kitchen counter or in your studio or at the coffee shop around the corner. So I think it's really supportive.
And we'll come back to this, but you have some impressive alumni and alumna, but I want you to talk about that in just a minute.
Of course.
So I want to jump on to Catherine. So Catherine, you did the program. When did you do the program?
I completed it in the summer of 2017.
17, so fairly recently.
Mm-hmm.
And so tell us a little bit. So did you always have an idea for a book for like years? Is it one of those things and finally you just got it out?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I had wanted to write the book for a long time and had just had a really hard time getting it done on my own. And then I came to a USM fair, graduate school fair, and met Justin, and I said, why should I do this program? And he said, well, you know, some people do it for this reason and that reason, and some people have a book in them. And I said, okay.
You have a book in you.
Yeah.
So he had mentioned the importance of the cohort. Was that helpful to you in your process?
Oh, yeah. That was everything.
And having a bunch of other students around to kind of give you feedback and also for you to think about what good writing is from from looking at their work.
Absolutely. Yeah, I found the people that I worked with were so dedicated and so just took the program really seriously, really just amazing peer editors and And also moral support. You know, there were definitely a couple times where, you know, when you're a writer, when you're an artist, there's a place where you're just struggling so hard and you can't see the light at the end of the tunnel. But I felt like
they were there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We talked about this backstage, actually, that the cohort's still in touch and still gets together and talks. And I think that's one of the things, the sustainability of the program, that it's important that the students, it's not just there while they're in the program, but that it helps them in, throughout their career as writers.
Yeah,
she's got one book in her, but she's got more books in her,
I suspect that's true. Yeah. Exactly right. So, Catherine, tell us a little bit about the book, if you can. Give us a little taste of it, and we'll tell people where they can go get that book.
Well, this book is a story of after college, I went off to live in Thailand and work at a refugee camp. And I met a local Thai man and fell in love, and we had three kids and had a very idyllic life.
Yeah, yeah.
And then our second son was diagnosed with leukemia, so quite suddenly everything changed, and it's really the story of that journey with him through his illness and ultimately his death.
I'm so sorry.
But it's all, I think what's part of the thing that makes it interesting is that it takes place in Thailand and you know, in my ex-husband's extended family.
Wow. Do you believe everybody has a book in them? Only special people have a book in it.
That's a good question. Everybody's got a good story.
Yeah, everybody has a good story. Not everybody can be a great writer, though, I think, and it sounds like you have become one, and thank you for sharing that. Mm. You can pick it up at Longfellow Books. You can pick it up at print up on Congress Street heading towards the East End.
That's
you can pick it up at BAM, and you can pick it up at Amazon. Is that right? So, again, I'll just make a little plug for one of our alumna. Now You See the Sky, and it sounds like a powerful, powerful story. And sorry for your loss, too.
Thank you.
Justin, going back to you, tell us a little bit about some of the impressive catalog of people who have jumped out from this program into the world and been very successful.
Right now, one of the heads of Penn International is Jennifer Clement, who's one of our graduates. The writer Patricia Smith, who won the Kingsley Tufts Award a few years ago, she's one of our graduates. You know, we've got Jed Coffin living
$100,000 award, too.
That's true, really, yeah. That goes away. There's money in poetry, it turns out.
Yeah.
But we also have graduates that are living in Portland, that are developers downtown, that are attorneys mid-coast, that are surgeons. You know, we've got people from all walks of life that had that experience, had a book in them, or the book that they wanted to find in themselves, and they came to the program to do the work to get it out of there, to pull it out.
Pull it out, yeah. And that, when you see that in students and you have that ability to kind of nurture that or pull it out in a way that they find is giving them both a combination of discipline and support that they need, it's a pretty powerful
combination. It takes a ton of discipline to put yourself in the chair and to face the blank page. It's the same thing with any job. Right, you just have to keep
exactly
putting yourself forward and doing the work.
I was just listening to Tahisi Coates, and he was at a conference and he was speaking, and he said, people think that, you know, writing's glamorous and it's easy and it just comes out of me. He said, I spend the first 4 hours of my day basically writing things of which I will keep only about 20%, and most of it, it's not as good as it should be, and it doesn't go anywhere. So that's what I have to get up and do every day. It's not as glamorous as you might think. So let me finish with this. In terms of writing, what was the best part of doing that novel? Was there something that really, was it the fulfillment of getting that story out of you, or was there something else that you found by putting things in writing and telling this memoir, Catherine?
Well, for me, it was a really important part of my healing. I feel like the last step in the healing journey since my son's death. Because you just have to feel so much and face so much to get it down on the page, and then to keep going back again and again to edit. I really feel like, I teach that writing can be so healing, especially in grief.
Yeah. Justin Tussing with us today is director of the Stonecoast MFA here at USM, and with him is Catherine Murray, a graduate of the program and the author, once again, of Now You See the Sky. So congratulations to you for getting that out. Wonderful, and congratulations. And Justin, thank you for the terrific work, the pride you bring to USM and bringing this national level program to the many people who take advantage of it. So thank you very much. And thank you for listening for the February USM update. We will return for the March update in about 30 days. Again, I'm Glenn Cummings. Thank you for listening. We appreciate it very much. And we are honored to bring you the great stories of USM through the USM Update. We'll see you next month.